this for the grant invitation. I'm honored to be here, and I think it's quite an interesting topic, not only for you, but for me also, to share some thoughts and to hear also the story at the other countries. Yesterday, when I was in the same hotel, I was watching on Bloomberg, Charlie Rose had invited Joseph Stiglitz, he's a Nobel Prize economist, and they were debating on the same topic. Topic of fiscal consolidation in America. And even though he is a Nobel Prize winner, obviously he was also puzzled, and he didn't have any particular cure that could work from tomorrow. So, it's a topic that I'm not presenting any solutions, just my view and my experience in a topic that we can elaborate later. Still, I think that Bulgaria is one of the good examples. There are several reasons about it. We heard them. First, what was the situation before the crisis, prior to the crisis? Of course, we had gold. For 5 or 6 years, we had a huge gold. Budget surpluses, this is something that differ in many countries. We had surpluses driven by mainly foreign investments. Foreign investments in Bulgaria were record high in 2007. They reached 40% of GDP. So the boom and the, all those money from the United States and from Europe, the expansion of the monetary policy, actually, the bubble that was created was presented in Bulgaria as foreign investment, it's a place with low taxes and a place that you can invest. So, yes, we wrote our direct taxation. We have from 2007 10% flat tax on corporate income, and 2008 10% flat tax on personal income. And it's as simple as you can imagine. You just see what's your income at the end of the month, you divide by 10. There is no threshold, no any particulars, no need to write what industry are you working for, are you working for yourself or for an employer, you just divide by 10 and the result is your tax. It's probably the simplest flat tax that can exist. We have a growing fiscal reserve, that's something that's puzzling for many people, but it actually means that the surpluses that we had in any particular year was put in a special saving account of the country. But why is it puzzling? Because we have a currency board and we have a currency reserve, which is the reserve that's supposed to lay behind our currency. But the fiscal reserve has nothing to do with the currency board. This was puzzling even from Citibank and our investment banks that were saying that we have problems with the currency board because of the fiscal reserve going up or down. They have nothing in common. This is just a saving account for the government. As I said, the budget revenues were dependent on foreign investments and consumption, as our tax code is mainly oriented in consumption. And the VAT income is mainly dependent on imports. So when you have foreign investments, this leads to current account deficit, more imports, and this leads to a lot of revenue from the state. And when the foreign trade collapses, you don't have investments, you don't have imports, then you have problems with revenues. And even in the good years, we have a severe social security deficit, mainly with pensions. We have a demographic problem, we have a problem of few less people working. Even in the good years, they never reach 70%, they were 62-65%. The workforce actually at work. So we have a severe social security problem even in the good years. What happened with the crisis? As you can see, we have growth above 6%. Then in 2009, and unfortunately this was the year of the elections, so when the budget was made, it was said that we would have no crisis. So it was a generous budget. The most generous budget in the Bulgarian history was the budget of the crisis years. So our economy collapses, you can see minus 8%, this is quarter data compared to the quarter of the previous year. Then we recovered in 2010, late 2010, we have a bit of recovery in 2011, and again, you see that we are again with a recovery with another recession probably in Europe, and our growth is around 1-2%, probably the latest. What happened with revenues and spending? As you can see, in 2007-2008, these are the surpluses, and these are surpluses after the spending at the end of the year, because 1 month before the end of the year, the state sees that there is a huge amount of money, and they say, okay, let's spend half of this huge amount of money on infrastructure or whatever. After they spend it, this is the surplus that is left. So it's 2-3% of GDP, and without the spending in December, it should be like 6-7%. So huge surpluses. Then in 2009-2010, you see the drop in revenues by the lack of foreign investments. There was an accountant debate that some of these deficits is probably in 2009, but this is not important for this this presentation. The main point is that we were in an excessive budget deficit procedure in 2009 until 2011. As you can see, it's entirely driven by the downside of the revenues. You see the spending, it's actually going curve, a little bit slower, but still no actual cut in absolute terms. The revenues finally reached their pre-crisis level in 2012. So we have 3-4 years of revenues being in absolute terms less than before the crisis. And this is the projection with the new budget. Just last week it was presented. But now we are in a rather more balanced situation with budget deficit of 1%. And actually, again, record high spending for our history as we have written. So it's not a, you don't see much of austerity pictures here. This is the fiscal reserve. It's important in our story. You can see this is billion less. You divide by 2 and it's euro. So you have 6 billion euro in reserves. This is like a saving account for the government just before the crisis. And when the crisis hits, this is what we actually use. This is spending in December. You see the crisis is not here yet. They say we have lots of money, we spend a few. And then with the crisis, you use this as a buffer. So, again, crisis facts, revenues down, tax revenues recovered in 2012. What was interesting is that the revenues from income taxation was the only type of revenue that went up. So, you cut your income tax from 22% and 24% to 10% tax, and you have increase in revenue, and this increased preceded the crisis. So again, every year we have more revenue from income tax. But again, our tax code is to consumption, VAT, so we still have problems. The spending was up, despite the official freeze on pensions and salaries. When you have more pensioners, you still spend more money, even though you actually freeze the pensions. There were a few particular pensions that were indexed with 3-5%. But the other interesting thing is that in 2009, as I said, just before the elections, 1 month before the elections, the pensions were increased by almost 20%. So again, you see politicians doing something the last month, and you end up with a huge deficit. What was also up was all the benefits, the social security system. Even though you don't change anything in particular in the role, when you have more people unemployed, when you have more problems in the economy, it drives the social system spending up. So you have freeze on pension and salaries, but still more spending. So excessive deficit 2009-2010. And overall, to make the long story short, you have 5 billion less, which is 2.5 billion euro, which are the total amount of deficits in 2009, 10, and 11, And they were entire covered with the fiscal reserve. The drop in the fiscal reserve was actually the same amount. So we were lucky that the crisis hit us in 2009. If it hit us in 2007, we won't have the fiscal reserve and then we'll have a huge problem. Crisis measures on the revenue side, not so interesting as in other countries, no major changes, 10% tax, 20% VAT, 20% for whatever I remember, at least 10 years. Only the excise duties up as every year, it's a traditional measure in Bulgaria since 2007, we are catching up with EU excise duties. We had a huge increase in cigarettes in 2010, and again, what you see is less consumption, more smuggling, and problems with revenues. So, excise duties being up, it doesn't lead necessarily to more revenue. Some minor new taxes, this was used by the state. For instance, on insurance premiums, if you insure your car, now you pay 2% as a tax. This was never been the case before. Also, tourism tax, it was a fee before, now it's a tax. Again, it should lead to more revenue, but if you combine all these minor new taxes, these two and other few, it's something like less than 50 million euros. So it's not that important for the budget, even if you cancel them, not in relation paper. And we saw increase in local and state fees. This is especially for the local administration was seen as a place that they can gain more money with untransparent fees, with no clear methodology. If you don't have enough money from taxes, you just increase the fees. People still should register their homes and their cars and everything, so they pay more fees. And no major changes in social security contributions. First they were cut with 1-2%, then again they were raised, so nothing major happened in the last 5 years with social contributions. I know that in many countries the private contributions were cut or something like this, but in Bulgaria it didn't happen and there was no debate about it. It's 5% pension on the private contribution. On the expenditure side, as I said, there was a freeze on pension after the populist increase in 2009. There was freeze on salaries in the administration. Again, it was not that transparent. We just had a huge scandal on bonuses in some of the agencies that get their own revenue. For instance, anti-monopoly agency or something like this. If you find business with a huge fine, usually, because it's the larger business, then 25% of this fine can be distributed against the people in the administration. So it leads to, for instance, salary of 1,000 less, or 500 euro a month, and a bonus of 1,000 euros. So the bonus is even bigger than the salary. So it ended with a big scandal and changing the law. So now the bonus can be that much, can be bigger than the salary. Also, the capital expenditure were used as a buffer. So you put in the budget some amount, usually a relatively big amount of capital expenditure, and depending on where the budget is going, you will either do this expenditure or you just hold them and leave them aside. Something that that was used in the previous years was a 90% rule. So the money you give to administration, they hold them at 90%, and the last 10% they can be spent if nothing unexpected happened. So, for instance, if a major crisis hit or the revenues are down, then those 10% are safe. This is interesting rule and a buffer that is doing no harm in the good years and is useful in the bad years. There were some changes in social securities to answer the rising cost. Mainly, we can mention the retirement age in Bulgaria, 63 for men, 60 for women. This is the official one, but we have a huge retirement. So the official age is 57, 58. And if you look at the data with all the policemen and firemen, military being men, then actually women in Bulgaria are retiring later than men. If you look at the official data, not just the numbers in the law. What we did in 2010, we raised the retirement age, but we said we will raise it with a little bit for 2020. In the next year, the budget exploded, of course, because this change was, has nothing to do with the next year budget. So in 2011, the government said, okay, we were wrong, and now the retirement age is being increased by 6 months every year, starting from this year, 2012. So we understand that changing it a little bit from 2020 is doing more good. And something quite bizarre, we had delays in payments for business, of course. Government and business has made regulation. If you build a road, you give money to some businesses to build it. And when the crisis hit, we delayed all these payments. And even at some point, after a year or something that you can't receive your money, the government tells you, okay, if you want to receive your money this week, you should receive a 10% haircut on what we owe. It's not obligatory. You can wait for your money, but what will you do more days? So many of the businesses accept this. And again, it shows that many of the economic forces are politically driven. Some roundabout policies, so-called secret funds, these are part of the fiscal reserves. For instance, healthcare reserve, part of our contributions with healthcare go to special reserve that nobody knows what we've done with it, but all will be used on healthcare in the future. What we've done is that when we wanted money, decided to transform this healthcare reserve to just reserve and spend it on good healthcare. So this was a huge debate, but it happened. It's 1.3 billion less. They were my contributions, another workers' contribution on healthcare that was spent on just budget. The pension reserve, the silver fund, was also put into question, even bigger amount than this on healthcare. But at the end, it survived with. We used the IMF to push, the European Commission, and the people are more reactive on pension reserve than the capital reserve, I don't know why, but in the end the government was not able to actually touch it and spend it on something else. And we have a huge story in private professional pension funds. The government nationalized 100 million less. After that there was a constitutional court ruling, which was really nicely written, which said that these are private money. They are not money of the pension fund, not money of the national social security system, not money of the government. These are private accounts, private money. And even the constitutional decision attacked some of the official statements being presented in front of it as not right. Burden on businesses, some income policies was shifted to private sector, rising minimum wage, the minimum social security threshold, so the government said we don't have money to raise salaries and administration of pensions, but we will shift the burden to private sector. The result was employment is the only macro indicator that is still going down. Shifting social security costs to business, for instance, the first 3 days of illness are now paid by the employer and not by the state fund. For instance, if you get ill, you are secured with the state fund. So the state should pay your salary for the time being you are ill, but the first 3 days are actually paid by the employer, which is, again, kind of strange policy, but the idea is to not to have abusive behavior, I think. Budget rules were accepted in 2011, just last year, and they are quite tough. We had the old rule for the for the debt of being 60% of GDP. Now we have the consolidated government expenditure cannot exceed 40%. Whatever happens, this should be the limit. And the budget deficit cannot fall below 2% of GDP. Of course, after that, there was European rules that we should also accept. So probably there will be some change here with cyclical adjustments and stuff like this. But still, the idea of budget rules is quite popular in Bulgaria. Also, these rules are debated on constitutional level, should be put them directly in the constitution, which will mean that they can be changed by 2/3 votes in parliament, which in its present situation is quite tough to do. Some conclusions. Austerity in Bulgaria. Bulgaria was actually freeze on salaries and pensions. There were no actual cuts in absolute terms of something that happened, like at least in Romania, for instance. In Bulgaria, thanks to the surpluses in the good years and the fiscal reserve, there was no need for actual cuts in absolute terms. But the freeze on salaries and pensions worked quite well because of the inflation and the drought again in the last few years. Deficit. Now, actually, our fiscal reserve is a critical minimum. There was no healthcare reserve, just a silver fund, some nuclear reserve from the nuclear power plant. So, for now, we have deficits, we should finance it from the international markets. We don't have any saving account. Okay. Income policies were shifted to the private sector. This was politically wise, correct, good. Because you can speak of the policy and not the budget, but the employment is still, as I said, down. This is the biggest problem in Korea. Half of the people that are work, actually work, and half of the inactive or employed. And at the end, as expected, in 2003, which is the richest budget that we ever had, we will see rising in pensions and salaries. This was actually a long-term policy. It was stated numerous times in 2009-2010 that such raising the cost will appear in 2013. This is what we promised to the European Commission and every respectful body. So, budget 2013 will be quite interesting. We depend on growth, we depend on consumption. And obviously employment, so there are no clear buffers written in it, and we can have quite intense debate in the middle of the year if things are not going well. Something from the end, we already had an experience in 2010 to write a budget that is not adequate to the situation. So in May 2010, we had a huge debate in revision of the budget, a strong revision of real cuts from what was promised. So I hope that in 2013 it will not be the same story with the tradition in the day, and that we can move forward. Okay, thank you for your attention. I hope you'll have time to read it later after the presentation and after that when we have COVID. Thank you.